Well, it is multiple times of day, and if you've tuned in, this will be a one-shot of Edge of the Empire. For me, it's the middle of the afternoon. For one of our members, it's just after dawn. And for the other, it's about to become tomorrow. So please forgive us if we are in altered states. This will be a one-shot, as I said, for Edge of the Empire, meaning we're going to be exploring the system. My two guests have not played the game yet, and we'll try and make it as difficult, life-threatening, challenging, and fun as we can for them. So without further ado from me, let's introduce the players and characters. Let's start with Red Dice Diaries, and you're up.
Okay. So I'm John from Red Dice Diaries, as Runeslinger said, and for this one-shot, I'm going to be playing Jamori, who is a Twi'lek smuggler who was born into life, as many of his tribe are, as a Hutt slave. He escaped and received some training by a mysterious figure that died during the Imperial purges, and since then he's dedicated himself to trying to find a way to rescue his people. However, that needs money, and it also needs a ship. So he's turned to, shall we say, the less savoury pursuits in order to make ends meet and finance his one-man, well, now two-man, liberation crusade. And he has a strange knack of sort of convincing people of what he says. He's a very charming person.
Ooh. Jason?
Yes. I'm Jason from Mr. Mephisto's Geek Manifesto. It's my YouTube. And I'm going to be playing a Gan by the name of Shivox, who has left his home planet in search of fame and glory as an up-and-coming fight, which are basically Gan hunters who... That's kind of how they gain glory in their culture. So, yeah, I'm just starting out on my path.
Cool. All right. Now, these gents have been traveling together for a while, and we'll see how they fare together today. Here is our non-scrolling intro scroll. I've tentatively titled this one-shot Grasping at Ghosts, and we say, it is a dark time for the galaxy. Striking out at the elusive Rebel Alliance, the evil Galactic Empire has brought the central sectors to the brink of war and beyond. On the Outer Rim, those who have fled the tyranny of the Empire are no better off, as greed, graft, and the territorial battles of criminal organizations have fringers squabbling over table scraps, while multi-system corporations dream violent dreams of acquisition and domination. The Korla Sector, forgotten and distant, set between Hutt space and the Arkanis Sector, is one such battleground. Rebel agitators, underworld operatives, corporate security, Imperial agents, and the incessant whispers of new frontiers to settle, far from all the chaos, have made the settled worlds of Korla a crossroads of chaos. Drawn by dreams of fame, credits, revenge, and freedom, as many come to Korla as flee. Lured by rumor, goaded by desperation, full of plans, on the edge of the Empire. Yeah. Our location is Vev Station, a very large sector control station, orbiting a mining world, Vev. The planet itself has an atmosphere unfit for oxygen breathers, requiring environmental suits, and most beings who pass through the system spend most of their time on Vev Station or hoping to gain access to the luxury world, Vev Prime, hoping to stay off of the prison planet. only known by its imperial designation, a long string of numbers that no one can remember. Imperial forces in the system include one large picket ship, which spends most of its time in this system, but occasionally makes runs for collecting prisoners all through the Korla sector and through the Arkanis sector. Underworld organizations, well, you can't throw a stone without hitting members of the Ten Loss Syndicate or Black Sun or any number of local up-and-coming wannabes. Bounty hunters flock to this region looking for people on the run from the core. The information trade is starting to compete with this system's mining of the very rare and very restricted mineral cortosis, which the Empire has put under restriction. So, our welcome back. Our two characters find themselves in a wild, almost lawless orbital station. Ships coming and going, ships locked in a holding pattern, waiting for their chance to dock. Imperial forces and station staff barely able to restrain the chaos, keeping the ships entering and leaving in some form of organized pattern. They are looking for a Bothan, an information broker, fellow by the name of Wreck. He's normally easy to find, liking to hang out in the upper class bars on the lower decks of the station with the best view of the swirling gases of the mining planet below. But these days, he's been harder and harder to find. We open up, leaving the docking ring, which occupies the center of a long cylindrical station. There are two docking rings on either side, circling each other as it hangs in space, and there's a lower docking ring set up exactly the same way. One is mainly blocked off and restricted to Imperial traffic these days, but in your early journeys here, it was a free-for-all. Since you've last been here, the Empire has taken much more of an interest.
Okay. So, presumably, have we just arrived at the this station?
You have checked on your ship, which is supposed to have been ready.
Mm-hmm.
But is not. Wreck is the one man who should be able to help you track down the fellow who is trying to repair it and has stiffed you.
Okay, I'll turn to Shivox and I'll say, Dad, the ship was supposed to be ready for this time. How are we supposed to keep an efficient operation running with shoddy repairs like this? Look, and he sort of looks around as though he's worried that an Imperial enforcer is going to come marching round the corner, and says, lowering his voice slightly, says, look, I know the Empire is taking more of an interest in Viv Station. Everyone's got to keep things a little bit more on the down low. But the fact is, if we don't have a ship, we're stuck here. We're going to have to try and find Wreck.
Nah, I agree with you, and I don't particularly want to be stuck on this station. It reeks of oxygen, and I don't particularly like that. So what do you suggest we do, my friend?
Well, I know that the last time I was here, I mean, granted, that was before all of this. Well, they started slapping the Empire symbol on everything, and there weren't quite so many troops and Imperial ships stationed here about. But the last time I was here, I remember Rec had a fondness for some of the public bars, the entertainment lounges on the station. I don't know if we'll find him there, but that seems like a good place to start. And if anyone knows how we can find this repairman, this mechanic, and make him see the error of his ways for reneging on our deal, then it would be Reg. That Dan Botham's got to be about here somewhere. What say we hit some of the recreational lounges? And I know that's not really your thing, Shivox. I know there's probably a bit too much oxygen in the air for you, although I quite like it. But what say we make our way there, and we'll see where we go from there. Although obviously you're far more of this whole hunting people down and finding them is far more your area of expertise than mine.
Yes, it is my area, as you say, of expertise. I suggest we start with the recreation lounge, as you so aptly suggested. And I think I have a thing or two that might convince this mechanic once we find him. But first, onto Wreck. So let's move about.
All right.
Indeed, let's go.
Gentlemen, if you could bring up the DICE app.
Yeah, I've already got it loaded.
Okay. And select one force die, the white die.
Mm-hmm.
And roll it.
Okay, mine has come up with one dark side.
One dark. Shivox.
I also have a dark.
Okay. So, your destiny pool now is 2 darks.
Are you able to see
well
our rolls, by the way?
Not yet. I can see mine, and I can see Jamuri's. Okay. Now, just to see, we ended up with a 64, by the way, for obligation, meaning no one is particularly under stress at this time.
Right.
Does not mean that your obligation won't present itself, and it doesn't mean that you can't pursue it. It just means that it's not weighing you down emotionally.
Okay.
Sure. All right. So, from the main docking ring, below that is the promenade. There are central elevator shafts, a large number of them, around the central core of the station. And on the outer rim of the station, there are occasionally elevators. These tend to be restricted for maintenance staff, Imperial staff, and the like. So there's always a mad press around the corridors leading to the elevators. There are many levels. There are living quarters, and there's the huge promenade where all the shops are, where the bounty office is, where the Imperial recruitment and monitoring station is, and the open bazaar where unlicensed vendors try to hawk a variety of materials. Below that, we get into what we call the recreation levels. This can be, from time to time, a little dangerous as gangs stake out this territory.
I'll probably have my sort of hand go to my sort of my holdout blaster that I've got concealed about my person, more to reassure myself than to actually pose any danger to anyone else, since I'm not the most competent person in the world. That's why I hang around with a bounty hunter, so I never get involved in all that stuff. That sort of thing. I'm much more of the smoothly talk my way out of a situation and leave before the gunshots occur. But so I'll probably be sort of sticking quite close to Shivox as we go into the sort of the more dangerous levels of the the station.
Okay. Question. What kind of weapons are accepted in this place? Like, can we open carry? Or
concealed carry is often more of a problem than open carry. And heavy weapons are typically a problem, mostly because of the environmental effects of blasting away while on a station in space. There are certain parts of the station which are older than others and may not react well to holes. But personal weapons, you know.
Okay, so a blaster rifle?
A blaster rifle is you know...
It's conspicuous.
It's a little conspicuous.
I like conspicuous. So I'm going to have Verda. That's the name of my blaster rifle. Her name is Verda. Okay. And I'll be, you know, she's slung across my shoulder. I have my holdout blaster concealed as well.
Yeah, okay. you know Shevox that I've got a sort of holdout blaster concealed on my person, although you'll know that I'm absolute. In fact, it might even be your character who gave it me to sort of personal protection, but you will know that my character is absolutely abysmal at using it.
What's this called? A barrel?
Exactly. You've sort of schooled me in the sort of point this end at the person who's trying to attack you and squeeze this bit here, but beyond that, Jamori's not really of that persuasion.
All right. So you move down through the promenade, find an empty elevator, move down to the lower levels, and it's almost a maze. You know, generations of spaceborne dwellers have turned this around. So instead of the normally easy to follow layout of the upper decks, it's confusing. There are dead ends. There are obstructions. There are places to hide in the darkness. And at the end of these corridors, there's always some kind of access point guarded by bouncers into a bar that just hopes that the Empire won't come poking its nose in. Some of them have spectacular views of the stormy surface of the planet below, but many just have views of junk docked ships and other parts of the station. Wreck is known to hide out in what's called the Gold Shot Club. A lot of members of the CSA make it a point to drink there, especially those members who work in security, not, you know, CEOs and corporate execs. And it's on the topmost lower level.
To the sort of door or the entranceway to this bar, is there any sort of security on the door or anything of that kind?
Oh, yes. And it's of maybe, let's say, two levels. There are two competing gangs on this level, one quite young, like up-and-coming teenagers, the other more established and known to be vying for recognition in one of the bigger syndicates in the area. They prowl these decks and keep away, you know, people who are too good for this level. And then there is the club security, the bouncers. The majority of species here are human, and on the planet below, you know, there are large numbers of Gamorreans, so occasionally you find them up here. But, yeah.
Okay. So I'll assume we head towards the actual entrance. I'll be sort of keeping a bit of an eye out. So I know the area is sort of prowled by these gangs, and we don't, much as I'm sure that Shevox could like take care of any situation we might come across, we don't want to draw any unnecessary attention to ourselves, especially with Imperial forces so close by. But I'll be keeping a sort of nervous eye out for that, just nodding at people as we walk past, trying to not look too much like a tourist, basically.
You notice that Shivox is blissfully ignorant of any sort of Imperial presence, and he seems to delight in like swaggering down the corridor with his blaster rifle in full view.
That's why we get on, though. Much as I've basically, your character is like the bigger version of my holdout blaster. You're there because you've got the swagger, and it makes me feel a bit more comfortable knowing I've got a practiced bounty hunter who's not bothered about the Imperials next to me. So I can just do the worrying and the fretting and leave all the sort of shooting and fisticuffs to yourself. All
right. As you move around these curved corridors, it's difficult to see too far ahead or too far behind. And the corridor is becoming much narrower. Now, at the end of this is the entrance to the Gold Shot Club. You're not that far away, but this is a great place for an ambush. And if I could ask you to check your vigilance.
Okay.
The difficulty, this is a known environment.
Okay.
You're not, surprised by having to look for potential gang problems. So I'll set the difficulty as standard, which is 2 purple.
Okay, 2 purple. Now, I believe as well, because I've got a sort of uncanny knack for sort of noticing danger, that if that's applicable, I can add a boost dice to it.
That's correct.
Which is the blue dice. Well, let's see what I get then.
Okay.
Oh, oops. I did that wrong. Ignore that. I forgot to add the difficulty. Okay, there we go. You said it was, it's a two difficulty?
2 difficulty, yeah. So 2 purple and then your vigilance.
Oh, it's not looking good for me despite the...
Triumph, baby.
I'm glad one of us did.
Yeah, I triumphed on that, which is... And 2 successes, so 3 successes. And 2 threat.
Okay. So 3 successes, triumph, and 2 threats. And okay. So Jimuri, it's an empty hallway. It's the same as it always is. There are there's no sign of people around. Now for Shivox, the fact that there's no people in this hallway is the big war. Normally there'd be punks hanging around and, trying to look cool and that sort of stuff, but there's nothing.
Okay, I mean, completely oblivious to anything that may be going on, Shivox will hear my character sort of let out an audible like sigh of relief, and then he'll start walking down this corridor, absolutely secure in the knowledge that for once there's no skirmishes or anything like that going on in this forsaken part of the station. He's like, just get into this bar, we can get this dealt with, and we'll be on our merry way. Beautiful. I love when a plan comes together.
Before you get too far ahead of me, I reach out and I grab one of your head tails and kind of, halt your progress. And I say, Jimuri, we have a problem.
Now, you earned a triumph, which can be applied in a variety of things. You can use it to avoid difficulty, right? You could use it to turn the tables on those who are setting up an ambush for you. You have a mild palate. You got 1 triumph, not a collection of triumphs, but this is enough to, let's say, as it's described, turn the tide of battle, or overcome an environmental setback, or recover some injury or strain that you've been under. So how do you think that you'd like to approach your triumphant vigilance in this situation?
I definitely want to use it to take a maneuver before. I want to, you know, see where the ambush is coming from and see if I can act first, basically.
Okay. Now, this hallway curves around, and at the end of this curve, that's the access point to the Golden Shot. And the hallway is half as wide as it's supposed to be. Right? It's been filled up with junk and detritus to leave this path. And if the ambushers are the young gang you think they are, they're probably up on top of the rubble in among the pipes and conduits, waiting to drop down on their unsuspecting victims. And in fact, you can see a dangling foot from a conduit just a few meters ahead.
Okay. Just a few meters. Wow, that's close.
The sole of the foot is pointed in your direction.
Well, I'm going to back up as much as I can to get, you know, put a few meters distance between us.
Just like back around the curve?
Until I can just see, until there's just line of sight.
Okay.
Are you dragging me along with, or...?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll be sort of being dragged back. What are you doing? Trying to hold onto my head tail so it's not ripped out of my skull.
You see me pointing and gesturing towards the pipe. I don't say anything further.
Yeah, it's definitely there. That's a young human's foot in some kind of garishly decorated boot.
I'll sort of be a little bit more wary at what Shevox has shown me, and I'll, for once, I'll actually go quiet, since although my character likes to talk a lot and he likes to sort of swagger about, he is appreciative of the fact that the Gan probably knows more about these sort of dangerous situations than my character ever has a desire to learn about.
So we haven't encountered this gang before, have we?
I haven't needed to.
Okay.
What should we do?
I think that we need to be a little cautious, We have to make it through here. We're on a bit of a time crunch. Let me just see here what we can do. And I'm gonna switch my blaster rifle to stun.
Okay.
What you mean you've not been walking around with it on stun anyway? My weapon's been on stun since we got here. I don't think I've ever taken it off stun.
Exactly.
Stun reduces the range to short.
Right. And I am going to fire at the foot and see if I can hit it.
Okay. Okay. So you are in short range. You are basically firing from surprise. I'll still need you to fire to determine the effect, because we've just got the foot. All right, so are we stunning or not? So your difficulty here is 2. So 2 purple. Okay. And I'm throwing in 1 setback die for all the conduits and whatnot.
Okie doke.
So 2 purple, 1 black from my end.
Okay. Now, I have 1 ability and 2 proficiency, so.
Okay.
go ahead and give it a roll. Anything else?
Well, are you taking your time? Are you? Would you like to aim? For example, this is an the use of a maneuver to aim will add boost dice.
Yes. Let's aim. Okay. Let's take aim.
So one blue die as well.
Okay.
And let her rip.
All right. That was terrible. One success.
Okay. One success is enough. Okay. So, weapon fires. You definitely target the youth who, I mean, even though the foot was dangling, the youth has clearly gone limp.
Okay, at this point, if we've seen that the foot sort of gone limp, my plan is, as part of a bluff, effectively, or a deception, to basically shout out in a very imperious sounding voice that I'm going to try and put a lot more confidence into than I actually feel at the moment, to go, there, that's what you get for impeding official business. Let that be the lesson to the rest of you. You'll get out of here if you know what's good for you.
Okay. So let's see just how effective you are at all of that.
Okay. I'm assuming that would be deception.
Yes, because of the context of you having the might of the Empire behind you, yes.
Okay.
Well, that's cool. And two successes and two advantages.
Two advantages.
With a chorus of expletives, you hear a rustling in the pipes and conduits above and running footsteps overhead as this tough teenage gang forsakes the field, leaving only this one dangling boot behind.
I'll sort of pause to like mop a couple of beads of sweat off my brow, sort of, again, sort of going, thinking, oh, I'm glad that worked, because if it didn't, I'd got nothing. then I'll say, I know you're into all this bounty hunting business and whatever. I can see I see that foot still there, Shevox. Do you want to have a quick glance at it as we walk past? I know we're on a bit of a schedule, but I know you like to keep your hand in with the trade or whatever it is you call it.
Yes, you just stay behind me. I will keep an eye on the foot. But
if you insist.
Yes.
And I'll quite happily stay behind him.
And I'll not march ahead, but I'll stride confidently and probably even forget to take a look at the foot, to be honest.
Well, as you pass the foot, I guess, it does have a vibro knife tucked dramatically in the top of the edge of the boot, and the gang colors have been sprayed all across the boot itself.
Now, with my knowledge of the sort of the local underworld, would I know anything about the specific gang or what gang these colors represent?
Yeah, these guys are the Steam Gang.
Okay.
Not a terribly inspired name, and they've recently been terrorizing the lower levels. Basically holdups at gunpoint minor threats. They haven't killed anybody yet, but it's just a matter of time, before they go.
I'll say to Shevox, I'll say, oh, we need to be careful of these Steam Gang types. I've seen some of the bulletins on them recently. They've been responsible for a number of robberies. They've got over quite a few credits on some of the lower levels. We should probably keep an eye out just in case they just in case they decide to circle back once they're once they get the nerve up.
Yeah, thank you for the information. I will keep an eye out, or two eyes, as it were. And you see his eyes kind of twitch because his eyes are like on the sides of his head, like a fly.
I'll reach down and I'll pick up the vibro knife and sort of holding it at arm's length, sort of dangling by the handle. I'll hold it out to the gander and say, it's probably best we don't leave this youth with a dangerous weapon like this. Perhaps you should add it to your collection, Shivon. Yes, it wouldn't go with my outfit.
Okay, I can hold on to it. I can see that clearly you're uncomfortable with deadly weapons, but I'm used to them, and so I will hold on to it.
Some of us are born to maim, some of us are born to entertain, Shivox. That's just the way the universe works.
Well, you do have a prettier face.
Well, yes. don't worry, you've got your own sort of rugged, deathly bounty hunter charm, I suppose. Well, anyway, that's neither here nor there. Look, let's get into the gold shot and
from the end of the hallway, you can hear the sound of rusted metal grinding against rusted metal, and you hear someone screaming out suddenly, and a very angry human voice saying, "I've told you kids to stay away from here." And the very, very meaty sound of a fist striking someone.
We can't see it yet, you said?
Can't see it yet, but you're not... It's loud. It's not very far away.
Well, I think we can guess where they went to.
Yes, I think we should help this individual. I don't like to see these punks. Back on my planet, we don't have punks running around in corridors. We do noble things like eating bugs and hunting. So, and then with no further word, he just kind of charges off down the corridor.
I sort of grimace at the mention of eating bugs and then follow along anyway.
Okay. At the end is a very nondescript door. It looks like a maintenance hatch or something like that. It has a small security control panel next to it. But there's definite signs that this is the front of a bar. You know, there's bottles and other litter out front. The bouncer and one other large figure are standing in front of that door. And you've just seen him throw this young kid, maybe 10 years, into the wall. Just the one kid. Get out of here. Tell the rest of those steamers to stay away from this corridor. Now, he's nicely dressed. Right? Very sharp. Paramilitary style. Doesn't really fit this corridor very much.
Brush a few imaginary specks of dirt off my own clothing.
So I approach him and I say, "Would you like me to shoot that punk for you? I've dealt with those kind before."
The guy who's leaning back against the wall, he just starts to laugh. And, you know, the one who is all physical, he slicks his hair back and he says, "Yeah, no, it's okay."
Are you sure?
I'll put a hand on Shivox's shoulder and I say, "You must forgive my." My bodyguard, he's very, very comprehensive in carrying out his duties, and he takes a great delight in dealing with these punks that you mentioned. He's not terribly fond of people like that. I'm sure he'd quite happily shoot them for you, but as you say, station regulations and all that, more's the pity.
Well, someone should take a bounty out on those punks.
Well, if someone should take a bounty out on them, I'm sure I can think of at least one person who would be very happy to collect on it, my good man.
I am looking to build a resume.
Oh. Another out of work bounty hunter. You'll fit right in. Gentlemen, the entertainment tonight is excellent, all the way from Vev Prime. known to have entertained some of the wealthiest clients, and so I'll have to ask you for 5 credits each.
Yeah. Hand him over 5 credits if Shevox looks to be sort of rummaging around in his pockets, and I'm aware he's probably only got sort of knives and guns and stuff like that. Yes. I'll just hand over 10 credits and go. That should pay for myself and my bodyguard.
Excellent. Well, you have access to the facility for the entire night. You can keep your weapons, just don't use them. If you do end up needing to use them and the rest of the room decides that you were in the right and you live, there'll be no problem.
As we sort of walking in, having paid the bouncers, I'll pause, look back a little bit to Darlow. I'll slip the bouncers a few extra credits, and I'll say, thank you very much for your help, gentlemen. I was hoping to meet a colleague of mine here. I don't suppose you've seen him this evening.
Well, that depends on the colleague and his attachment to privacy.
I'll be sort of dropping the credits in as I'm saying that, and I say, he's a tall fat, well, tall for a boffin. Goes by the name of Wreck. He was supposed to be arranging some repairs to one of my vessels, and well, I don't seem to be able to track him down. I know he's frequented this club before. I was hoping we could meet here and banter about the cost of things over drinks and entertainment. I don't suppose you've seen him at all.
Okay. Well, you are being quite charming, I assume. Backed up by credits. The credits themselves will add boost, the blue dice, to this roll. And normally, I wouldn't ask for a roll in such a situation, but perhaps he's under other coercive force to not talk.
Okay. Not a problem. So how many?
So you get your charm.
Did I just want me to add?
The difficulty will be hard, I'm afraid.
That's fine. That's 3. Is that 3? Okay.
3 purple, and you have 1 boost die for being willing to part with credits.
All right, and I also get 1 boost die. So that's fine. Yeah. Okay. Let's see what we get. So I'm on 2 successes.
Right on. He looks both ways. He takes, he puts his arm up as if to put it around your shoulder, and if you don't, object, he walks you down the hallway a little bit and then says very loudly, while holding up 1 finger in front of his chest, kind of blocking the view of the other bounty hunter, says, "No. I have not seen Wreck here at all. He's not at his table like he normally is. I'm sorry."
I'll say in an equally loud voice in response, I'll say, "Well, that's a shame. I was hoping to meet him here, but I suppose we'll go in and now we've paid to get in and we'll enjoy the entertainments. Thank you anyway."
You're very welcome. You will enjoy the entertainment.
And I'll head back to Shevox and say, again, in this sort of almost artificially loud voice, well, it looks like he's not here, wink, but let's go inside anyway. We deserve a bit of a relax and a bit of entertainment after the trying events of today."
Not having eyelids, he totally doesn't understand your wink. And so he pulls, you notice him reaching for his pocket, and he pulls out what appears to be some sort of dead rat, and he sticks it in the maitre d' or whatever your name is, he sticks it in your pocket and thanks you for giving us admittance.
You're welcome.
we'll head in.
And the door opens as you approach it, and the inside is nothing like the outside.
Okay.
It's quite wide. The narrowness, the artificial narrowness of the corridor has not really prepared you for what it's going to be like in here. That it opens up quite far on either side of the door, and you're on a rounded set of stairs down into the room. It's a two-level bar with privacy booths everywhere. Rounded and shielded by light. There's no physical obstruction that will prevent you from walking up to a table, but the way that the lights are, there are pools of shadow around each table. The walk-up bar is straight across the room, and behind it is a panoramic window looking at all the traffic circling the station. And distantly, the rest of the planets in the system lined up almost in conjunction. The entertainment is off to the left. There is a stage, and that's where most attention in the room is focused. There are some people standing around the stage, but most are sitting at tables. The non-private tables are simple round tables with their own light source scattered across the floor. It's about 100 meters across. It's a very large space. There are probably also private rooms, not here at all, which you would need to be escorted to by staff. It's a large, attentive wait staff, mostly human again, and although there are some Twi'leks.
Yes, I was going to say, since obviously my people are known for being the sort of entertainers of the universe with both the positive and the negative sides that entails, I'm going to look around for members of my own race and basically see if there's any who aren't sort of performing or providing entertainment at the moment, or sort of waiting in the wings, as it were, and see if I can approach them without drawing too much attention to myself, hoping to sort of blend in and people go, it's just a couple of Twi'leks talking to each other. One of the advantages of being the sort of entertainers that everyone expects is people don't tend to pay a lot of attention when you're not on the stage.
The main bounty hunter, the main bartender, I like saying bounty hunter today, the main bartender is a human who's not entirely human. One whole arm has been replaced by a very massive, very industrial-looking cyber arm. And he's all done up with leather straps, not in a kind of lifestyle choice, but kind of holding his body together appearance. He has two additional bartenders, both of whom are Twi'leks. Some of the waitstaff are, but most of the waitstaff are human. The entertainment tonight is a singing and dancing duo, a human and a Twi'lek, both female, and they are performing something that's almost tribal, telling a story about a noble fight. And you know, the human is doing very little of the dancing, but is using a body language to kind of send images of the emotion of the struggle, where the Twi'lek is moving around with her body language painting the scene of high on a mountaintop, a noble temple, and two enemies coming together for a clash. And the audience is watching with rapt attention.
I'll be sort of, having been sort of walking over towards the sort of Twi'lek bartenders to speak to them, I'll pause momentarily and watch the dance for sort of like a minute or so. Jamori seems sort of lost in thought for a few moments as he's watching it, and sort of shakes his head a little bit and carries on walking towards the bar.
How about Shivox?
He's not paying much attention to the dance. He's just kind of keeping an eye on things and seeing if he can see anybody who looks like they're trouble.
Well, the whole bar is filled with people who look like trouble. But they're all wearing their best clothes, and they're there as couples or as small groups. More for social reasons, perhaps. There are a few openly wearing the CSA uniform, and the corporate sector authority, or in the browns of that group. And some of them have personal bodyguards in the latest body armor, trying not to be seen. But for the most part, these look like mid-level gangsters and their number twos or their spouses.
Okay. As I get to the bar, I'll try and sort of arrange it so I've got to the bar near where one of the Twi'lek bartenders is. And I'll sort of almost carelessly, I'll take my two chance cubes out of my pocket out to be sort of idly rolling them on the bar, and as they finish serving whoever they're dealing with, I'll just hold my hand up to gesture for a bar person.
She comes over and gives you the cool professional look.
Speaking in real, the sort of home language of the Twi'leks, slide a couple of credits across the bar and I'll just basically point at something to order it, since I'm not entirely familiar with the menu in this establishment. So slide some credits across, and then as the drink's brought back, I'll lean in a little and say, again in real, just in case anyone's overhearing it in a low voice, say, excuse me, I'm looking for a colleague of mine. We were supposed to play a few rounds of chance cubes here this evening. I don't suppose you've seen him about, and then I'll lean in a bit closer and say, in actual fact, I'm fully aware of the table he's supposed to be sitting at, but I didn't just want to approach unannounced. I was wondering, would it be possible to get someone to escort me over to his table? And I was sort of holding my fingers up, I'll mimicking the guy at the door, I'll illustrate which table I believe Rec to be on.
Right. She goes, table two. Oh. And she starts to laugh and brings out a cloth to clean the bar top and scoops up your credits. And she goes, she's pointing at the stage, right? And her body language doesn't match at all what she's saying. It's like she's talking about the entertainers,
Yeah. So,
from stage right to stage left is table one. So Rex is table two. You can clearly see that there's nobody sitting there, but there is a drink sitting on the table. Okay. Maybe five rows of table between where you are and where that table is.
Okay. If she doesn't say anything else, I'll ask how much it would cost me to get three of whatever drink is sitting on that table.
She says, it's a very cheap drink. She says, it's good. She says, but he's in a meeting now trying to book passage. And he's in that private booth, and you're not getting in there. But I can escort you to his table if you like.
Yes, if you could. If you could get me those three drinks, then I'll have one for myself and my companion, and I'll point to where Shitty Box is standing, sort of scanning the room, and then we'll have one for our friend when he comes out of the meeting. And I'll slide the requisite credits across the bar.
Okay, she very happily takes them and prepares the drinks.
And one for yourself if you would like, or to take the credit, whichever you prefer.
I work here, I don't drink here. She slides them into her apron.
Keeping your personal life and your professional life distinct, a very wise choice.
And she summons one of the waiters. A human comes over to escort you to, she just says, table two.
Okay. I'll hopefully scoop up Shivox on the way past. I'll sort of put the drink in his hand. If he shows any confusion, I'll be like,
He takes the drink before he sees you motion. He takes the drink and dumps it on his head, and like he's like rubbing his scalp with it. Ah, this is a wonderful ointment. It's very perfumey.
I'll be sort of sipping mine and like indicating it with my hand, as in this is what you do with it.
Oh, I seem to have confused this with an ointment and a remedy on my home planet. Pay it no mind.
I'll go, and then I'll pass over my drink to him and say, never mind. Let's carry on to the table.
Okay.
As you wish.
So you get a couple of annoyed glances as you're being moved between the tables because the performance is reaching its crescendo. I mean, the swelling kind of music is throbbing the entire room, this vast room. And you're quickly seated. The waiter scuttles off. And what you see is the Twi'lek rush in suddenly, the human performer on its knees, right? And again, with body language, you get the sense that the head of the human has just been cut off. And the way that the lights work, you lose track of the human's face, but you can still see the body.
I'll sort of momentarily go as though I'm going to sort of like jump up in my seat before sort of realizing, no, they've blatantly not actually just chopped someone's head off. we're in a bar with a massive Imperial presence like just nearby. So I'll sort of go, oh, wait, what's... Oh, no, it's fine. Or without like vocalizing it, though, just sort of he goes to stand up and then sort of caught for a moment, looking actually quite angry, and then sort of realizing, oh no, it's fine, and just sitting back down. I put the drink I've bought for Wreck next to the other drink that's already on the table, and I say, oh, Shivox has got my other one. I say, Shivox, since it's less easy to notice when you're actually keeping an eye on something, if you could keep a watch on, and I'll sort of try to be surreptitious, I'll indicate with my thumb the private booth that I believe Wreck to be at. He's in there. I've been told we're not going to get in, but keep an eye on that. We need to know the second he comes out in case he tries to make a run for it or evade us in any manner.
Okay, he just nods.
Then I'll go back to like sort of clapping or whatever is appropriate for the entertainment. So it looks like I've just been talking about the entertainment.
There's lots of people clapping as the suggestion of the body tumbling forward and the lights go out. And then, you know, as a thunderous applause, and the two performers come out and they bow, and then the house lights come up a little bit, but shift to a blue tint, so that it's still quite dark, and it's difficult to make out details of faces as you look around the room. It's a very private bar, and there's a low murmur of conversation and mild, unobtrusive music in the background.
I'll say to Shivox, I sort of point approvingly at the lights and say, well, of course, all the best things in life are blue, Shivox.
Yes. If that's what you believe, then so be it.
Now, Shivox, you're able to spot a Bothan who walks like your contact Wreck. The lighting is confounding recognition of by fur pattern, but it's probably Wreck. He's making his way toward the table, and he's slowing down as he recognizes that people are sitting at it.
He's slowing down, making his way to the table?
Yeah, he was heading toward the table with kind of an angry body language, and then he's slowing down, and now he's stopped as if undecided, and he's shooting a look at the door, and he's shooting a look at the bar, and he's standing there hesitating between the tables.
I'm going to just pretend that... Well, I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to keep an eye on him, and my eyes are on like the sides of my head. I don't know how that plays out in like game functionality. That's probably
would have a wide field of vision.
right. I just don't want him to know that I'm watching him, so I'm not going to do anything.
Okay. It's kind of sad, really. You can visibly see him muster the courage right? And then he tucks in his chin and he moves to the table, pulls out his chair with a mock show of courage, and sits himself down. And with his voice shaking only a little bit, says, "Welcome to my table."
Slide the two drinks over to him that were on the table.
Well, this makes you more welcome at my table. And he just tosses one back. Anyway, puts it down, his hand is shaking. And he says, "So, Jamori, is everything okay with your ship?"
"Unfortunately not, Rek," I'll say with a less than comforting smile. The technician you acquired to do the work doesn't appear to have completed his task. There's still several subsystems on the ship that need repair and maintenance before we can actually set off. It's a little, well, perplexing and disappointing, I'm afraid. I was, when you said to me that you've got people to sort out the job, I took you at your word. The job's not been done.
I didn't know. I'm sorry. I take responsibility. You're right. I connected the two of you together.
That's fine. We're civilized people. I'm not here to assign any blame to yourself. I'm simply here to find out what's going on and see how this situation can be resolved in the most efficient manner. After all, I need a shipwreck.
He's almost crying.
Don't we all?
You know, he blots around his eye with the fur of the back of his arm, and he says, "Jamori, I can't help you with your ship.
That's disappointing. I mean, if you don't mind me asking, you seem to be in some sort of distress. Now, as a given our long association with each other, and aside from this current blip, it's always been a fruitful association. It pains me personally to see you obviously in such great distress. Is there any assistance that I would be able to offer to you?"
I don't know. He's looking around. He says, "There is a bounty hunter after me. And, you know, and I didn't do anything. It's a total mistake. But the guild won't listen. I was just talking to the guild. I got to get out of here."
Well, perhaps if you were... What is it you're supposed to have done according to this bounty, if you don't mind me asking?
Murder.
I'll sort of feign a look of shock and horror and say, then lean in a bit closer and say, "Really? And who is it precisely that..." Obviously you haven't, but who is it precisely that you're supposed to have murdered?
You've heard of the planet Tatooine?
Yes, of course. Who hasn't?
There's a powerful Hutt there, a Jabba the Hutt. And one of his lieutenants disappeared, and they've decided that he was murdered, and they've decided that I did it.
That's most unfortunate for you. Given our previous friendship, I'd be more than willing to help get you off this station. But unfortunately, as I've just said, our ship's currently in the repair dock.
Well, this is my way to make it up to you. I have a ship.
I see.
And I can't use it. He's been following me. I got to get off the station in a different way.
Okay, so if I'm correct, and having forgive me if I am misunderstanding, having just seen the stirring spectacle of that that interpretive dance behind us, I find myself quite moved by it. Or so perhaps I'm mishearing. You're proposing to a trade your ship that you cannot use for our ship that's in need of repair. Is that correct?
We change titles. I'll sell your ship for whatever it's worth for running money.
I see.
You take my ship and promise me that you'll leave this station. Noticeably. And then do whatever it is that you want to do.
I see. So you're hoping that the people who are following you will follow us in the ship. They'll obviously find out that they've made a mistake, but by that point in time, you'll be long gone with your running money.
And they'll have no beef with you, and you'll have the title, and it'll be legit, and I just sold a ship, that's all.
I'll sort of reach my hand out in a gesture of agreement, sort of shake his hand, and I say, well, that all sounds most agreeable, Rec, and to be perfectly honest, and I'll sort of lower my voice and look around, I would probably still agree to this deal, even if you were guilty of killing one of the Hutt's lieutenants. But enough of that anyway. Let's arrange the transfer of the titles for the ship as soon as possible. Then I can assure you that my friend and myself will leave the station in a very obvious and public manner.
You're kind. I'm not used to that.
Everyone needs a break or a second chance now and again, Rec.
This lieutenant I'm supposed to have killed? There's two things you need to know about him.
Okay.
First, his name is Rin. He kind of made his name kidnapping and selling into slavery with the Hutts, your people. He always said he had an eye for talent.
I sort of presume I'm still shaking his hand while he's saying that, and momentarily my grip on his hand will grow tighter as he mentions that, and I'll sort of leaning in a bit closer say, well, whoever did commit this murder, I would say that they've done the galaxy a great service by removing such an individual.
Well, that's just it. He's not dead.
My grip will grow really tight when he says that.
He's been captured, and I know where he is.
Captured? By who?
This part. I'm sorry, but I have to ask for money.
How much money?
How much have you got?
Okay, I'll start looking through my pockets, and I'll say, well, given the expenses we've paid to track you down, I've only got about 20 credits on me in personal funds.
He's trying not to show the fear on his face. He's, do you have cargo on that death trap of a ship?
Well, yes, there's some cargo that we haven't been able to trade. I'm afraid that most of it's only got a week or so left on the expiration date. Soft goods, mostly. That's why we're on such a tight time schedule, and we were so keen to track you down. We don't want our goods to spoil while we're trying to get our ship sorted. I mean, whatever cargo is on there, if you can take it as recompense, take it.
I'll take it. Done. Fine. It's always... Then he gets a grip on himself.
Can I see if this guy is lying?
Sure.
I don't necessarily trust him, seeing as how I don't have the same vested interest like my friend.
Okay. Now, if you'd like to work together, this is also a possibility. While I'm pretty sure Jamuri is kind of emotionally off kilter, he is asking the right questions to expose some lies.
Yeah, I'm quite happy to assist my bodyguard with this task. How does that work in terms of the actual sort of dice pool?
We have two options. If you both have the same skill, but differing levels, you can take the largest number from each of you. So just as an example, if Jamuri had 3 in cunning, and Shivox had 2 in, oh, I don't know, vigilance, mm-hmm. right? But only had 2 in cunning, you would use Jamuri's cunning and Shivox's skill. Right? So you'd combine them together. If you do not have the same skill in common, or there's no numerical difference between them, then by the act of assisting, you contribute boost dice.
Okay, so which characteristic and skill would we be looking at in order to ascertain whether Rec is telling us the truth?
Well, Shivox, as the role would be yours, how are you thinking of approaching assessing the lie? The skills are quite broad, so take a look at what you've got there.
And right.
We could do it as simple perception, and that would be fine. Streetwise.
I was thinking more of discipline, because it almost feels like he's trying to sell something a little bit, like he's trying to, you know, sales.
So you want to be unswayed.
That's right. Yeah, pretty much.
Okay. Well, I've got willpower 2 and discipline 2.
I have willpower 3 and discipline 1.
Okay. So let's do it this way then. We'll use 3 dice with 2 proficiency.
So okay. So if you want to make that roll, she looks at your.
Oh, you want me to? Why don't, yep. Runeslinger, why don't you do it? Because doesn't it show up on the screen when you do it?
It should, yeah. Okay.
Okay.
So, and Jamuri is helping by asking all the right questions, and so that brings in a boost die. Now, Rec is a social animal. He's a practiced liar. If he's lying, it would be difficult to note that. So I'm setting the difficulty at hard. Okay. We haven't used any of the destiny pool yet because it's black. You can't. So I'm going to use it to make this a little more challenging. So I take away one of the difficulty dice, and I add in a challenge die. Okay. So we're rolling 2 yellow and a green versus 2 purple and a red.
Before you roll, do you think it's a good idea, like I'm thinking if I was GMing, I wouldn't want my players to know if they knew or not. Do you ever roll these in secret?
No, the culture of play really is building it out in the open and then going from there, because there's so many impacts that come from the dice. Are there threats, and are there advantages? And you, the player, get to spend the threats versus the opposition. Right? And how are the advantages going to be spelled? And so on. So there have been moments where I have felt like I wanted to hide roles, but I've ignored that impulse, and it's been fun. Sometimes the conflict between IC and OOC knowledge can be entertaining. If only I knew that he was lying to me.
It certainly makes it easier to, like you say, sort of play up the. If you buy into it when you've like failed a role like really poorly and you know you've failed it because you've missed something, it makes it easier to sort of play up to that.
Yeah. All right. So we've got, like I said, 2 proficiency dice, 2 yellow proficiency dice, 1 green skill die, 1 blue boost die, 2 difficulty diced in purple, and I spent a part of the destiny pool to free it up for you guys to raise one of the difficulties to a challenge. So, rolling.
Okay.
And, well, look at that. We end up with a failure with advantage. So, the idea was you were using discipline to resist his sob story, his tale of woe. Oh, poor me, I'm a bothan on the run. But he struck a chord, my friend. But you have an advantage. One advantage. Much of his story is true. Maybe not all the details.
Okay.
All right. Well, tell us where your ship is docked. We would like maybe to have a look at it before we make this completely official.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely. Maybe.
Assuming, Rec, that as my friend wisely says, assuming we do agree to this, which I don't see there being a problem, as long as the ship's as advertised, then how soon can you have the titles transferred over to us?
Within an hour, while we're waiting for the cargo to be moved to the promenade.
Excellent. Well, why don't we go and have a look at your ship, and if it's as advertised, I'll make arrangements for my titles to be transferred, vice versa, and then we can all go about our way with a pleasant and profitable transaction carried out between us.
All right. Okay, good. Now, I don't want to go through the main door. If you don't mind, I'm going to show you something that you can't reveal to anyone else.
On my honor, you have my word that I will not reveal what you show us to anyone else.
What exactly are you showing us? Your hollow porn stash?
No, a secret way out of the gold shot bar.
I'll sort of look as though I was going to ask a question when the Gan says hollow porn stash, and then I'm like, no, there's not time for that. I'm like, show us your secret way out then, right?
Okay, so he says, meet me over there, and he's pointing in the direction of the restrooms, right? He gets up and he goes and pays his bill, right? And he's really digging deep in his pockets to pay this off. So you buying him a drink probably saved his life.
I'll give it a few moments, and then we'll start sort of making our way across. Yeah.
Now, he remains clearly in view the whole time, atypically of him. He would normally be moving through the shadows, staying out of view. That's his character. But he's quite obviously paying his bill, is getting ready to go, right? And he starts moving across the floor to the stairs and then gets pulled aside by one of the waiters, taking him in the direction of where he asked you to meet him.
Okay, well, we'll head over and meet as arranged.
Right. And this, like I said, is over near the restrooms, it's over near the kitchen, and it's close to the access point to the very private chambers that might be on a different level. And quick as you please, you're ushered into a service corridor. And he's moving quickly down the corridor past the kitchen. There's all kinds of screaming and steaming and flaming and other terrifying things going on in there. And someone's yelling that, you know, get the droid out of the kitchen, and then you're out in a normal access corridor, clearly no longer in the bar. And when the panel shuts behind you, there's no sign of it.
Now, did we have to get anyone to sort of specifically help us out through that secret exit, or is it
one
that anyone could use? Okay, I'll as we sort of meet up with Rec, I'll be intending to ask, how would one go around getting a regular use of this exit, just in case I should need it when I'm back this way again?
Well, you're in the right business. The only way to get that kind of privilege is to be willing to trade in restricted goods with the owner.
I'll smile broadly and I'll say, well, perhaps I'll attempt to effect an introduction later. I assure you that the trade of certain goods doesn't hold any issues for me. But anyway, enough of that. I'm letting myself get distracted. Let's get down to your ship.
And what he would be talking about is a negotiation would take place with the bar owner, and you know, Jamuri the smuggler would have the opportunity to take on more obligation for this privilege.
Since I presume he doesn't want to like start a big discussion with the owner at the minute, while there's I'll take because obviously time is of the essence for him.
I'm running for my life. Let's go shopping.
Exactly. Yeah. So what I'll do is I'll take the owner's contact details off him, and I'll sort of record those. Then I'll make a mental note at a later date to basically go to him and say, "Oh, Rex suggested you might need some cargo moving. Got a ship? Can help you out with that."
Cool.
And then we'll just carry on to
Rex is at hand. Relaxing a little bit, and he's maneuvering himself to be between Jamuri and Shivox most of the time when the corridor is wide enough. You know, he's always looking over his shoulders and just worn down by stress.
I'll be sort of walking along thinking, wait a minute, he's trying to put himself between us in case some sort of firefight breaks out. Well, I know that type of behavior. That's normally what I do.
He's really good at it.
Yeah, I'll just sort of, without saying anything, I'll just sort of like, I'll give an appreciative nod. I can admire a man's ability to get out of the way of harm.
So he takes you through many corridors and access points that you might have otherwise overlooked, you know, being a relative newcomer to the station. And corridors that are clearly blocked off, corridors that stay, you know, dangerous, that kind of thing. And he's making his way, and you're constantly working your way up. And, you know, this is where your bodyguard, Shivox, is earning his reputation. His eye is constantly moving, I guess, as you move through the corridors. And the paranoia of Rex mirrors the vigilance of Shivox. And there are many times where there's an upraised furry hand, and you know, wait, and the Bothan's ears are twitching, and it's hard to say what may have set him off. And Shivox, you pass through the territory of several rival gangs. And normally this would mean kind of a showdown or something with some wannabe warlord or, you know, gang leader. But there are whispers, you know, running through the crowd. You know, he just shot a kid. Just shot him. Didn't even say anything. Just shot him. This rumor's being passed around. And you're making your passage relatively unobstructed. You come out into a lower level of basically domestic units, housing. And there are two stormtroopers making their way slowly, carefully down the corridor. And Rick goes,
As we head round that corner, if we see the stormtroopers before they've had a chance to get a good look at us, obviously bear in mind that the Boff and Wreck is sort of like between us two, so presumably we'll be sort of like checking out the way to make it safe before we usher him down. Right. If we see the stormtroopers and we have chance, or maybe I get a sense that there's some potential trouble in the offing, I might say to Wreck, have you got a hood or anything you can wear to conceal your face slightly?
Yeah, good idea. He puts up his overlarge hood. Yeah. creating deep shadows around his face.
And then,
stormtroopers here usually don't mess with people, but when they do, there's not a lot of recourse.
Yeah. I say, look, I've dealt with this sort of thing before. Follow my lead. Just try and walk naturally like you own the place. Get a bit of a strut on. Hopefully, if they think we're supposed to be here, they won't cause us any trouble. It's not worth drawing the attention of Imperial forces at this juncture. Right. I'll sort of try and effect a bit of a sort of stride, probably sort of nodding at them as I go past, just sort of like, morning. Okay. And basically try and carry on walking, hopefully that they won't think we're being suspicious because we're just sort of walking through.
Now, for that kind of charismatic show, what is Jamuri's pool?
Okay, well, I'm going to attempt to use my... It's not really a deception, really, so I'd probably say it's charm, maybe.
Charm sounds good. What was the charm pool?
Okay, the charm pool for me is one of the green dice, the ability dice, and one proficiency dice.
And one proficiency die. Okay. Yeah, we'll have to roll that. There is an auto kind of success feature in the game. But these guys are paid to be suspicious, and they get to wear cool white armor while doing it, so let's get a roll there.
Okay, I would say if there are any setback dice, I get to negate one of them because I'm incredibly convincing.
That's
and
good.
I think that should help him too. Because
the blaster rifle was going to create setback.
Oh, bollocks.
But now it doesn't.
Okay, is there a way I can assist him at all, or
in this confident look?
Yeah.
Yeah, as you've described yourself, that fits right in. So you'll get one boost die, John.
Okay, excellent. So let me roll for that.
So you've canceled the setback.
Yeah, so that's three successes for my net.
Right, but we haven't added the difficulty.
Oh, sorry.
So we can just roll the difficulty now. Just add clear the dice that you, and then add in two purple dice.
Okay. Okay, so that's two failures and a threat.
Okay.
It's two failures total rather than two, is it?
No, it's a failure, and so you end up with two successes and a threat.
Right, okay, I see, yeah.
Okay, so they definitely look at you, right? And the threat I'm going to apply as strain.
Okay.
So, you know, that beads of sweat that you described before. So you're moving by the stormtroopers. Yeah, we got this kind of thing. And then that little bit of doubt creeps in. But then you're passed, right?
Okay, so do I need to record the strain on my sheet?
Yep. Okay, so you've earned a strain.
Okay,
you see, you've got a strain threshold. When that is met, you're at the end of your rope. Okay, one of the examples I like to use for that is Luke and Vader are fighting.
Yep.
Right? Vader reveals his parentage, and Luke basically enters a shutdown. He can't deal with the situation anymore. Right. Okay. So you're nowhere near that. You're just under some stress.
Okay, as we get past them, I'll probably pull out a small cloth from my robe to sort of mop my brow. Well, that was a bit closer than I generally like to get to Imperial forces, but they seem to have bought it. I suggest we don't hang around too long, though, in case they decide to take a second look at us, and I'll sort of speed up a little bit.
Rexus, I can't believe they didn't say something about that rifle.
Why would they say anything about Verda? Are you implying that she's causing problems?
No, my friend. He's implying that Imperial forces normally like to ask questions about people walking down the corridors of stations carrying bloody great blaster rifles with them. But I think in this case it actually helped. After all, we look to be a couple of people being escorted by a no doubt proficient, perhaps a bounty hunter, or maybe they thought you were one of our security forces, but whatever they thought, they don't seem to have given us a second look, but that might change if we hang around here, so I suggest we speed things up a little, gentlemen.
Right. So the main lifts are present. You can certainly make use of them at any time. Rec knows numerous back alleys that will take you a while to get up the levels, but if you want to take the lift, it's available.
Yeah, I suggest that if the lift is the most expedient way of getting there, we take the lift.
Okay. So you go up to the promenade level, where he briefly speaks to a contact about the cargo. And really briefly, he's like, I got cargo, can you move it? Yeah, and then, you know, forking over the money. Right. And then you're back in motion toward the cargo base, on the docking base, on one level up.
Okay, as we sort of head off into the bays, I'll be saying to Shevox, again, keep both your eyes out. We seem to be past trouble, but it's always possible that trouble finds you in a place like this.
I am well aware of any possible dangers, and I do have an eye out, so no need to worry there.
I know. I know you know all this already, Shevox, but telling you it's more to make myself feel comfortable.
Of course.
Of course. Of course. So, making careful point to avoid Imperial entanglements, as we say. Mm-hmm. Rec has you move up one level to where the ships are. Your ship is on this level also. And his ship is far closer to the exit, shall we say.
Okay.
And
I'm assuming for the... go ahead.
Yeah, go on.
No, I was just going to say, with regards to the transfer of the deeds, I'm assuming that had to be done electronically or something.
Yeah, once you board the ship, you can take care of it through the port authority. Okay. Now, his ship is a YT-1200, right? Which, it doesn't have a bad reputation.
As we make our way into the docking bay, Shevox heads towards like the completely wrong ship. It's some kind of like a souped-up sports machine, and is like, "This is a beautiful ship, and I think we should settle this deal right now, Jamori."
I'll sort of lean down, put my hands on his shoulder, and sort of gently turn him round to like look at the actual ship. And I say, perhaps one day when I'm a far richer smuggler and you're a far richer bounty hunter, we can get a ship like that. But I think he's talking about that one over there.
That one? Oh, I don't like blue. It's a
what's wrong with blue?
Color. It's terrible. It just, I prefer yellow. Don't you have a yellow ship?
I just have the one ship, and
it's fine. I'm sure Shevox will grow to love it. Blue, terrible indeed. Anyway, let's get on board and just make sure it's all as advertised, and then I'll use your systems to contact the port authority and arrange the transfer of deeds.
The ship does have a lot of blue. Many different types of blue.
And as all good ships should.
From a distance, it almost looks like a patchwork. As you get closer, the ship is much better maintained on the exterior than you were led to believe looking at it from far away. Like I said, it's a YT-1200, which didn't live up to its reputation, but still a pretty solid ship. And a lot of its Corellian engineering and a lot of its over-design has been stripped away through the years. And it looks more solid than you'd expect. Well-maintained, homey.
As someone who's used to flying around in a ship that's used for smuggling, I'll be sort of going around in a sort of like tutting, almost like a person inspecting a new car, you know, sort of like tapping various panels and giving it the once over, basically.
There are many places that could very easily be repurposed to holding things that aren't supposed to be there.
Excellent, that's what I like to hear. Well, I don't know about you, Shivox, but this certainly looks like a fine vessel. I can see it's no expense has been spared maintaining it, despite the fact it's a slightly older model.
I'll be the judge of that. And before you really can stop him, he pulls out some sort of screwdriver, and he's popping open like a service panel and kind of like just fiddling with things, and you notice that he's actually seems to kind of know what he's doing. He's tweaking something with a wrench.
Okay. Where? In the engine room?
No, just along one of the corridors.
Okay.
It's not a critical system.
Okay. Well, we can do that on the auto. The ship is called the Low Margin. This can be changed at the time of registration. He says, you know, the Low Margin's been with me for a long time and got me through many scrapes. She's not fast. I won't say that she's fast, but she always has gotten me home. She has a lot of secrets. She's seen a lot of stories.
Sounds like my type of lady.
I'm no engineer. He's watching as the screwdriver is working its way toward, you know, inner wall panels and things. But my engineer before he died, he loved the ship more than I did.
Well, my bodyguard, Shivox, is a man of many talents. What do you think, Shivox? Will she do for our purposes?
Can I do I actually have some skill in mechanics. I want to get an idea.
You have enough. I can just tell you. We're not repairing things while trying to be eaten by giant space whales and things. So, as you look behind panels and whatnot, the circuitry is in really good shape for a ship this old. The electrical conduits and whatnot. The indicators from the engine show you that it's in good shape. When he said it was slow, he wasn't kidding. No commercial freighter would be launched with an engine as slow as this now, but for personal use or for a smuggler who's clever and not relying solely on speed, it's fast enough. So basically what I'm talking about is there are classes of hyperdrive, as low as from 1 to 15, let's say. Most ships will have 2. The backup hyperdrive will be much, much smaller and slower. So class 10 to 15, somewhere in there.
Okay.
A luxury liner, a space yacht, that kind of thing that the customer would feel like can go someplace fast would have a class 2. Military vessels might have class 2, class 1. This is a class 3 hyperdrive with a class 15 backup. She is slow. Okay. But fewer things to go wrong.
I think this is an adequate choice for you, my friend. She seems to be in good working condition.
That's good to know, Shivox. And I'll basically get on the systems and start contacting the port authorities to quickly arrange the transfer of the titles so that a wreck can take ownership of our smaller vessel.
Okay. It has a capacity for 6 passengers, and in 3 staterooms, and for weapons, it has light laser cannons on the ventral surface. Okay. So it's reasonably well armed for a personal craft. Okay. Has a good sensor package. It's a good ship.
I'll sort of finish the transaction, and I'll be looking over sort of appraisingly at the weapons manifest, and I'll be saying, oddly enough, Shevox, I'm actually better at firing things like this in the depths of space than I am firing things like this. I'll say, waving my holdout blaster about, probably holding it by the wrong end.
Right. I'll believe it when I see it.
Well, let's hope you don't have to see it in the near future.
So Rick is really getting fidgety. So he's up in the cockpit transferring the title and talking to himself about time and he comes back and he says, can we arrange the transfer of the cargo?
Yeah, of course. I'll get on that now and arrange it straight away, and I'll start sorting that out via the link to the port authorities, giving my passcodes or whatever's necessary.
The port authorities can either be paid or take a commission of the sale, which is fairly normal for the unloading and offloading.
Yeah, it'll be on a commission basis.
they just kind of nod knowingly. Rec looks at the manifest and says, "Oh, some of these we'll get a decent price, you know," and puts on kind of a false front.
Well, let's hope so. It's been a pleasure to do business with you.
You too. He wants to shake your hand again. And he says, "So, Rin, he's still alive. Mm-hmm. He's being held by the rebels. You know, the Rebel Alliance against the Galactic Empire."
Yes, I've heard some rumors about them.
They've got him.
I'm not a much truck with them, to be honest. I'm more of an independent operator. I've got my own conflicts and my own wars to worry about without getting involved in theirs. But perhaps we will deal with them when we investigate this Rin. Anyway, thank you for telling me that. But down to more current matters. You said you wanted us to leave the station in a very obvious way. I'm assuming you want us to leave the station in an obvious way, but not being obvious that it's us leaving the station. Would that be correct?
That's correct. Yeah, they have to believe I'm here. So I was very visibly seen going on board my ship with 2 people. I've just arranged to transfer cargo, which is being brought.
I understand.
No one was going to see me leave this ship.
Well, that's fine. We'll wait until till your cargo's been moved off the ship, and then once that's done, we'll make all the necessary arrangements to be departing as soon as possible. Since I'm guessing we won't see you again for quite some time, if at all, Rec, I will just say that it has been a pleasure doing business with you, and I hope that you can find somewhere to lie low until this obvious mistake is rectified.
Thank you for that. Now the bounty hunter that's after me, he works with an assistant. He's lost his license. Unauthorized disintegrations on a core world. I don't know his name, but you'll recognize him by his armor. He has graphic hash marks of heads of all the people he's brought back dead down both arms.
I see.
Now, Shevox, this sounds kind of familiar, as like a ghost story you were told way back when considering joining the guild as a bounty hunter. If what Rec is saying is true, this guy's fairly old and has a reputation, or is an example of having a reputation of cruelty.
I seem to remember, yes, something about a bounty hunter. I think we need to be very careful in pursuing this sort of avenue. We could end up in a bit of trouble, the lethal kind of trouble, which I prefer to avoid if at all possible.
It's certainly my least favorite kind of trouble she evokes. But I'm hoping if we do encounter any problems or anyone asking to be let on board, well, since we don't, we're not going to have their quarry on board. We can simply let them on board, let them look through the entire ship for once. I'll be letting someone search ship and I won't be hiding anything on board. which is a novel experience for me, if nothing else. So hopefully we can avoid any unpleasantries. But what you sort of... have you mentioned the sort of like the bounty hunter's got a reputation for sort of cruelty and unlawful disintegrations, Shevox? Because that'll obviously make me slightly more worried than if I just think it's a standard bounty hunter.
Yeah, he tells you what he knows, that he's learned about him, and he's definitely not your typical bounty hunter.
Okay, well, in which case...
He's also stepped outside the kind of code that the bounty hunters have, and so I explained to you a little bit about that.
That's definitely concerning. Well, if we do get approached, hopefully we can broadcast the fact that we don't have the person on board. We can invite them to come and search the ship, so there shouldn't be any need for violence, hopefully. At which point I'll lean in close to Shevox, hopefully so that Rhett can't hear, because I'm assuming he's going to be sort of getting himself busy to be transferred.
Yeah, he's unpacking, or he's packing up his stuff. Yeah.
I'll say, Shevox, when we... I'm not saying I don't trust Rhett, but when we leave the dock as soon as possible, let's both have a quick look over just to make sure that there isn't anything suspect left on board, shall we?
Sure, yes. I was planning on doing that anyways.
Okay. So Rhett is ready to make his departure.
Okay, shake hands with him a final time, let him do his thing, and then as soon as he's off, get ready
and
to
then, depart. Before Rhett leaves, I fish out another dead rat, and I place it in his hand, and I say, this is my business card, and if you need anyone found, you just give me a call.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I'll stand behind him and say he's not joking. That is his business card.
Oh, I know. He bows to both of you, and he slips out through the cargo bay, moving very carefully across, avoiding cameras, points of view, and that sort of thing, ducking under ships.
At which point I'll request departure access from the port authorities and start doing the normal pre-flight checks, whatever they may be. And then sort of while I've set it up to sort of run that, hopefully myself and Shevox can slip into the rest of the ship while the port authorities are arranging our departure access and give it a quick once over just to make sure there's not any unpleasant surprises waiting for us when we depart.
Okay.
Yes.
So as I mentioned, it has quarters for up to six crew. Right. There's no sign that anybody has used these for quite some time. There are personal effects left, but they're all, you know, stored away in lockers. There's not much in the way of consumables for non-Bothans. You know, not like a wide variety of species were represented.
Well, my first priorities will be to check the obvious manifest and find that there's nothing like illegal or prohibited. if we say to someone, yeah, come aboard our ship and search it, they're not going to go, well, you're carrying these illegal goods. It's off to the Imperial Enforcement Authorities for you. And then the second will be, and more importantly, looking in the various secret places on the ship to make sure there's nothing in there that's going to take us by surprise.
Okay. The cargo bay is empty, clean, spotless. There isn't even like a droid to help out. It's just a cavernous space. The good places to hide things. Most of what's there are things like data storage devices.
Okay. Is it possible to tell from the data storage devices whether they're empty or whether they've got data on them, or would you have to
You can tell that they have data on them, coded data.
That I find slightly concerning, especially given the sort of data wars that are hotting up in the sector at the minute, and how much the illicit trade of information has really started to take off. If it's possible to do a sort of quick scan, either using my sort of comm system or the computer systems on board the ship, just to see what sort of encryption, because I'm assuming I don't have the necessary de-encryptions to access the actual data, just so I can sort of gauge roughly sort of how much trouble we're going to be in if we're found carrying this data.
Okay, so you load it up, and quite honestly, if there's a lot of encryption, you may not have the skill to crack it, or
But like I said, I'm not so concerned with cracking. It's more just a case of if there's an absolute shed load of encryption, I know it's probably serious stuff.
Right. But in the the rec room area, the lounge area of the ship, there are some very high grade computer systems. The sensor system has a console here tied in with weapons. You can't control the weapons from here, but you can follow along. The astrogation has also been rerouted in here. There's a very nice computer console that has been custom designed to help one or two pilots run the ship. And although you may not know how to do encryption and decryption, you probably have the tools here to do it if you learned. Okay. Once some of the sample disks are loaded up, they seem to be fairly innocuous. They're like public statements of corporate earnings and shipping schedules, shipping lanes, maps, this sort of stuff. Correspondence between famous CEO and famous CEO, and that sort of stuff.
Okay, once we've sort of established that, obviously not checking them all, just checking like a sample of them, I'll squirrel them back away in what I consider to be the most secure and most well hidden of the various spots around the ship, and then I'll make ready to depart from Viv Station.
Sure. Rick is paranoid. There are weapons, holdout blasters, vibro knives, this sort of stuff, secreted in lots of places. You may not have found them all.
That's fine. A certain level of paranoia is expected of any sort of smuggler, not to mention the fact that one who's got a bounty on his head, so I'm not too concerned about that. Besides, it'll be some nice surprises for like Shivox to like find around the ship when we get a chance to give it a real good once over.
Right.
So, set for departure.
Okay. The Port Authority gets back to you and says, about your scheduled flight plan, you're cleared to leave in 15 minutes, but there has been an Imperial hold placed on the ship.
I see. We'll comply with those regulations. What is the stated reason for the Imperial hold, assuming I'm permitted to know it?
One moment, sir. And flicks the comm to silence. Now, the bay itself is much wider than it is tall. Right? There's enough vertical space for two ships to fly, in above each other, although this would be highly illegal. Mm-hmm. And only one ship should enter a docking bay at a time. Now, Vev was famous on the space lanes for completely ignoring that protocol. Three, four ships would become charging in all at the same time and try and land. The controllers you can see gun ports mounted into the ceiling. The controllers can sometimes object forcefully to things like that happen. No sign of a tractor beam or anything like that.
Okay,
there are
yeah,
large ships there.
Yeah, I will be sort of looking around and recalling what I saw when I come in, thinking, right, if we do need to make a break for it, I'm thinking, how likely are we in the ship, given that I've looked over the weaponry, the speed of the ship, etc., how likely are we to be able to make a break for it without the station just sort of like gunning us down where we sit? I'm hoping it doesn't come to that, but I'm trying to consider all of the angles if we do need to make a run for it.
Right. Based on your skill as a gunner, you think it highly unlikely that they would want to use it while you're still in the bay.
Okay, and do I think we'd be able to... So I presume there's like docking clamps or something similar. Do I think we'd be able to detach them either using our own guns or otherwise, and or just the force of the engine on our ship, and be able to sort of make it out?
You could simply lift off and fly up.
Okay, basically what I'll do, I'll look over at Sheev. Well, I know Sheev, we've been together for a while. Which of us normally does the piloting, Sheevox? Are you an excellent space pilot, or you're on mute, dude?
Still mute.
Sorry. Can you hear me?
Yep.
I have one rank in space pilot, and I have three agility. So.
Yeah, I'm on.
He's decent.
Yeah, I'm on. My space piloting skill is one green dice and two yellow dice. I'm fairly
into that
myself, and I've got one yellow and two green for gunnery. So it's up to you whether you want to be the man on the guns or the man in the cockpit.
I don't have any skill. Well, I have three green in gunnery. What did you say you have?
Two green and one yellow. So if you're normally the sort of gunner and I'm normally the pilot, that would seem to make sense. Okay, yeah. Cool. So as we're sat there, I'll basically sort of, for want of a better phrase, put the ship in gear so it's ready to go. if we need to sort of gun it and zoom out of the space station, but just sort of keep the engine ticking over and warmed up. So we're not setting off from a standing stop, but not so that it looks as though we're immediately trying to escape, and just sort of play the waiting game. If I can think of any way of sort of stalling the authorities by asking additional questions about this Imperial interdiction halting order on our ship, just to basically buy our contact a bit of extra time to get himself away from the scene, I'll do that.
Cool. Could I get from you, both of you, a streetwise check?
You can indeed. What's the difficulty?
The difficulty, as you have familiarity with this place, will just be 2.
Okay.
But I'm adding 1 setback.
Okay. Okay. What I'd like to do is I'd like to use my sense danger ability, which once per session allows me to remove 2 setback dice from any roll to just like negate.
Perfect. Take them all.
Setback dice.
Also, we have a destiny point, don't we?
Yep.
So do we want to use that now or should we save it?
Never a need to save them.
No, let's use it now.
Okay. Do you want me to use it or do you want it?
Yeah. Should we go for it.
Okay.
And I'll make my roll for that.
All right. So I added it. I'll roll here.
Triumph.
It didn't upgrade my die. Why didn't it do that? Do I have to upgrade my die manually when I use Destiny Point?
It seems to. Okay. It just tracks that it's been spent. Yeah.
I need to re-roll that then. Sorry.
Okay.
So I'll click on that Destiny Point to change it over to a dog. So I'll point, there we go. That's that dog.
Okay, so we've got from Jamuri a success, advantage, and a triumph, which is pretty cool. And what do we have from Shivox?
Sorry, I screwed it up again, so I'm going to re-roll it. I'm not going to click on the Destiny again, because I think that would mess it up. I just manually manually upgrading.
Okay.
So just one sec here. Okay, so I have... Ooh, that was not good. Damn it. Oh, it's too... I failed and with two advantage.
Failed with two advantage. Okay.
Yeah.
So I'll fill you in. We've decided that you're the gunner, yes?
Correct.
Okay. So as you're getting ready to go, checking out the gun port and all that stuff, the normal maintenance crew has been moving around the ship. Okay. And they're pretty close to the ship now, and as they should be for a ship that's getting, you know, cleared to go. But the advantage, it's possible that the maintenance crew near your ship may not be all maintenance crew.
Mm-hmm.
Now, for Chimuri, Vev is known to be very open to bribes. Okay. And a paranoid Bothan information broker fixer like Rek would still steer pretty clear of Imperial problems.
Mm-hmm.
It's not outside the realm of possibility that somebody slipped a bribe to the port controller in order to delay you.
Okay, well, having just sort of spent most of my money in the pursuit of acquiring this ship, I know that I've not really got enough money to propose a counter bribe to the port authorities. So what I'll be doing is I'll effectively... is it that I can spend my... Is it the triumph you spend, or is it the...
Yeah, you can spend triumphs and advantages for different things.
Okay. What I'd like to propose, honestly, feel free to tell me if it's sort of above and beyond what you can use it for. What I'd like to propose is that from the triumph, due to my previous experiences as a smuggler and sort of having to get out of tight situations and knowing that port authorities are eminently bribeable, it's something I've taken advantage of myself on numerous occasions. What I'm going to try and do is I'm effectively going to try and power up the ship. So all I've got to do is sort of push the stick forward to go into a high speed. But I'm going to try and do it in a way to sort of, so it's not immediately obvious to the people who are outside. So I don't want them to sort of get in readiness and expect it.
Yeah, you can have the ship ready to go. And at a moment's notice, just ripping out and, you know, folding up the landing gear as needed be.
I've effectively got it ready to gun the ship out of here as soon as we need to.
Vev Station is not an easy station to escape from, but it doesn't have force fields in place. It doesn't have tractor beams in place. It's not worth it to them to maintain those. And the guns are more to keep people out than keep people in. They're not going to blow you up. If you're in here, you got a good chance of escaping that way.
Sure. Yeah, well, my thoughts will be that if we need to, I'll escape and worry about coming back and paying a bribe to get this ignored when I've got more money.
All right. Now, Shivox had started to grow suspicious about the maintenance crew outside the ship. And just as you got the ship, you know, kind of furtively powered up, this is when you get a signal on the console saying that someone is trying to slice their way through the door open console. So someone's trying to hack their way into the ship from the outside.
In which case, I won't even bother waiting. I'll gun the ship and out we go.
All right.
I'm not hanging about waiting for someone to hack into my newly decorated blue ship that I've just bought.
Wicked. Let's hack our way, or not hack our way, let's do a hard piloting check.
Okay, let's see. Piloting space. And Hards 3, isn't it?
Hards 3. I'm going to spend one of the Destiny pool on this. So it's going to be 2 purple and 1 red.
Okay. 2 purple, 1 red. Okay. Head tails crossed. Here we go.
Now, hang on. Oh. Because you were ready to go, and this is what you do, after all, okay. There's a boost die in it for you. So just roll that all by itself.
No problems.
Add it on. So we've got 3 successes, 3 threats. Whoa.
And that boost dice was another success.
4 successes and 3 threats. Okay.
What could possibly go wrong, I'll say, as I gun the ship forwards.
Okay. I'm not going to apply these threats as strain, although that might be a normal thing to do. I'm going to apply them as something else. So, you lift off enough, you blast out, and getting the body of Vev Station in between you and the guns, second nature.
I'll be shouting at my shoulder. I'll be like, Shivox, get to the gunnery turrets. We might need you in a few moments.
I'm on my way.
A really lackadaisical voice comes over the comm, you know, saying, low margin, we've detected that you have left without approval. Please join the reentry queue and do not attempt to leave the system. And then just hang up.
Oh, I was going to say... they beat me to it as I'm reaching out to like terminate the transmission and so turning the engine up to full power and bringing all of the ship systems online.
Zanari, I think these are some of Rex's friends.
Yes, I was rather thinking that I was suddenly realized, why am I shouting? We've got ship-to-ship communications. I'll switch those on. I'll say. Yes, I was rather thinking that we weren't going to get out of this entirely unscathed. I suppose that's the downside of being the bait for whatever Rex got set up. But let's see if we can't at least get those people away from here before they realize that he's not on board and turn back and our sort of engine to full and away we go.
Okay, so you push it up to top speed and you're ripping out of the system. Now, this is not a system that has its own star destroyer or anything like that, but the Imperials do maintain a presence for ships that they deem worthy to track down. There are, you know, military escort vessels. There are armed shuttles. There are TIE fighters and the like. None of this is scrambling to chase you down. This is a purely civilian thing.
Excellent. What I'll be trying to do since. Obviously, I do have. I've been in the system before. We've sort of flown about the system. You've given us a sort of rough layout of what exists in the system. I'll be trying to take a flight path that basically moves us in and out of as many obstacles as possible, sort of making it difficult for us to follow, in the hope that whoever is going to come after us will think, "Oh, Rex on board, and he's trying to give us he's trying to shake us off."
Right.
Make it a little more authentic, basically.
Are you heading out toward one of the hyperspace jump points, or you want to stay in system?
I'm quite happy to head to one of the hyperspace jump points.
Okay, so someone will have to start calculating the astrogation at some point.
I can do that.
Okay. So, you're reaching the point where, even if pursuit is launched by the bounty hunter or someone else from Vev Station, even at your worst, you'll be able to escape before they can reach you. Even like a fast attack craft. So your quick thinking, your rocketing out of the docking bay has definitely served you well. And a simple change of name on this very, very common ship, and they won't be able to pin anything on you. But that light about the airlock, it's still blinking. Someone's still trying to overcome the lock and make their way onto the ship.
I'll press the button for the ship's comm and I'll be like, Shivox, don't worry about the hyperspace coordinates for the minute. I think we've got bigger problems. Someone's still trying to get into the airlock.
I'm on
it. They must have grappled onto the ship or something. Go see if you can prepare a welcoming committee for them.
Okay. And I will head back towards the airlock.
Okay. Now, a message comes through on the comms. Not Imperial override, which would just start, but you know, a request to be answered.
Okay. I'll flick the comms to let the transmission through.
And there's just an armored faceplate of a fairly common model of ballistic armor. And it says, Rick, you can't keep running forever. Now, behind the face, you see the canopy of a ship and the interior of the Vev Station docking bay. So this person isn't in pursuit at the moment.
Okay. Given how long we've been flying for and sort of knowing when Rec transferred off our ship, do I think he'd have had a reasonable amount of time to sort of get far away from the station? So I don't want to sort of say, well, Rec's not on board if the Bounty Hunter can then just search the station for him, but if I think he's had time to get away, I'll probably sort of let the cat out of the bag, as it were.
Right. He's in the midst of his threat, you know. Like, you can't run forever. Come around, face the authorities. I'll make it easy on you. You know, you won't suffer, I promise.
I'll press the comm link and I'll say, this is Captain Jamori. I'm sorry, there appears to be some sort of mistake here. Who do I have the pleasure of speaking to?
Captain Jamori.
Yeah, and if there's a possibility to, do they have sort of vid screens, or is it just
yeah, screens, vocal? Yeah.
Okay, in which case I'll send the sort of visual output through, and I'll sit back in my chair and I'll say, yes, I've recently acquired this ship, and I'm making my departure from the system. Is there anything I can assist you with, Mister?
Ah! And he slams the screen off and connection is terminated. At the airlock, there's, you know, a readout which is calmly scrolling across saying, warning, the integrity of the airlock has been compromised.
Zamori, we have a problem.
Is it something you can deal with, or do you need me down there?
Well, that remains to be seen, but the airlock has been compromised, so I'm getting an itching and an inkling to flush whatever's in there out into space.
Well, you did say you thought that was too much oxygen. And yes, I'll start sort of looking at I'll look at the ship's controls and see if there's any way, should the airlock go, if there's any way of sort of sealing that area off from like blast doors or anything, to seal that area off from the rest of the ship.
Or cockpit whether it's can be sealed off, the lounge can be sealed off. And
okay.
But some of the interior quarters and whatnot cannot.
Okay, and basically I'll also look to see whether there's any way that I can effectively open the airlock and rely on the sort of blast of oxygen leaving, which I'll keep to as brief a moment as possible, blasting whoever's on the outside off into the inky depths of space.
Now, normally, that would not be the sort of thing that would be on a ship because of that kind of use. Right? The controls are right there. You have to be physically present at the door in order to open it or close it. But this ship has been rewired for exactly that sort of thing, remote control of various doors and the like. Now,
okay.
Shivox, you're right there. Right? Someone outside the ship has overridden the controls so that the outer door of the door lock will open and give them access to the lock itself. They'll have to repeat that procedure to close the door and then open the inner door.
Can I try and stop them from hacking the next door? Can I undo what they've done? I guess it doesn't matter because they've already come through the door, right? So
you can prevent them from closing it if you can outperform them as a a computer user, using either computers or skullduggery.
I want to try that with computers.
Okay.
Spend the destiny point, dude.
I already spent it. Unless we have another one.
I spent one, so you've got it. It's a continually refreshing pool.
Yeah, we've got another one now.
So the difficulty, this is an opposed roll. You're trying to resist them. So your difficulty is actually their skill pool. Okay. So they are coming in with one purple and two reds.
Okay.
So two challenge and a purple. Okay, so that would represent attribute of three and two ranks in the skill.
Right. Okay. All right. So if I use my destiny, I'm going to be at two green and one yellow. So this is going to be tough. But
now wait, you have the advantage because they're doing something illicit, and you're doing what the system is supposed to be doing. Okay.
Okay.
So you get a boost die for being on the side of. Being on the ship's side.
Mm-hmm. Just a question. I mean, obviously, feel free to say no. Since I've got access to the ship's scanners, etc., and I've registered that what's going on, and I can sort of see what's going on from my point of view, is it possible for me to sort of keep a verbal sort of notification for Shivox of like what they're doing at any moment to effectively see if I can give them the benefit of my... my uncanny senses, which would just give him like one boost dice, because I'm basically going, oh, now they're doing this, now they're doing that, you might want to deal with this.
That would be awesome. Another boost die.
All right. Let's do this.
Let's do it. Make it happen. Roll it well. What do you think?
it's a fail, and I also crit failed.
You get a despair.
Despair.
Oh. So you got one failure.
But I have three advantage, so...
Three advantage and a despair.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, well, needless to say, he's coming through. Okay, so you're trying to prevent the outer door from closing, which in any sensible circumstances would mean he wouldn't try to come further into the ship.
Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. Let me stop you real quick.
Okay.
Sorry, the dice app, I'm just reading the symbols on the dice. I have actually three total successes, and I have one failure and one despair. So I should still have one net success.
Yeah, it shouldn't show you the failures. So the successes are
Sorry, I actually do have one success. So I did succeed. My bad.
Okay.
But I still have a despair. So I have
and how many advantage?
One success, three advantage, and one despair.
Okay, one success, three advantage, one despair. Okay. Okay. So it's a stalemate for a while. Okay. Now the despair. The despair, much like the triumph earlier on, can be used to upset, overturn things. They also can be in multiples, right? This is just one despair. Now, obviously, you want to keep this person out, and just as obviously, they want to come in. You succeeded, meaning they are not in. The despair I will spend by having them lock you out of the internal computers.
Crap.
Is that just Shivox who's been locked out of them, or is it like a sort of system-wide lock?
So this particular airlock is going to need some serious repair or alteration or something along those lines. He's not coming in here, and you're also not getting out.
Okay, I presume that means it's no longer possible for me to sort of open the airlock to wash him out into space.
Right.
Okay.
So he may therefore be moving across the surface of the ship to find another access point in or do something else dastardly.
Okay, what I'll be doing then, since presumably I've registered the sort of lockout on the ship's sensors, I'll basically be keeping an eye out for whatever other airlock he tries to get in for, and as soon as he starts trying to fiddle around with it, I'll open that airlock and push.
Yeah. I'm going to have my gun at the ready, and I'm just going to... You know, I've talked to Jamuri and told him the situation. He knows I've been locked out, so I'm just going to be patrolling the ship.
Yeah, I'm keeping an eye out, Shevox, for if he goes to any of the other airlocks. I'll flush him out into space as soon as I get a chance. I'm securing all available compartments against the momentary loss of oxygen.
All right, so you catch glimpses of him on external sensors as he carefully moves his way with magnetic contact points across the top of the ship, moving over to the airlock on the exact opposite side.
Okay, whilst he's sort of clumping his way across, which I'm assuming takes a few moments, I'm going to look on the sort of astrogation charts for the area and see if there's any sort of minor debris like micro-asteroids or anything along those lines that I could potentially fly through, which wouldn't do too much harm to the ship, apart from maybe damage the paint, but that could prove hazardous to anyone who's stuck on the outside of the hull. Eventually, I'm going to try and scrape him off.
He's a barnacle. He needs to get scraped off.
You can certainly do that. Yes. One of the outer planets has rings of ice.
Excellent. I'll plot the coordinates into the controls, and I'll start sort of heading there at full speed.
Okay.
Keeping an eye on the airlock, because I'm still going to flush him if he gets to it.
You know all about the odds of piloting in an asteroid field.
Yeah.
All right, then. Now, in space, what makes things difficult is the speed at which you travel, more than anything else. Mm-hmm. So the speed that you set and the size of your ship will determine the difficulty of whatever maneuver you try and do.
Okay.
Now this is a... One moment, please. Just let me check its silhouette. There it is.
I'll basically be trying to just sort of dip into the very outskirts of the sort of asteroid field rather than like plunge directly into it, but I'm still aware that'll be quite a challenging maneuver.
All right. Now this ship has a top speed of 2 and has a silhouette of 4.
Okay.
And basically what that would mean is you look at half the silhouette or half the largest size thing.
Okay.
And that becomes the upgrade. So we've got a pool of 2 for the difficulty.
Okay.
Which is upgraded to 2 reds.
If it helps, what I'll do is as we sort of head into the lower, the outer sort of area of this ring, I'll sort of lower us down to the next speed category as we sort of dip in and then head out. I don't know whether that'll help or not, but certainly it'll make my character feel a good deal easier rather than plunging in at top speed.
Yeah, there's no reason to go at top speed. Yeah,
I've only just bought this ship, but I don't want to see it ruined.
Okay, so it gives you 1 purple, 1 red as your opposition for piloting.
Okay, and it's my space piloting, which I get 2 yellow and 1 green. I don't think I have any other modifiers.
Now, having a co-pilot working on the sensors and whatnot would certainly be a source of assistance.
Yeah, is it possible to get Shevox up here to like, help with that in the time we've got before we hit the asteroids? I know he's obviously down by the...
He can do it either from the lounge at the sensor suite that Rec had set up, or in his or come up.
Okay, I'll get on the comms and I'll say, Shevox, get to the lounge area. I'm just about to seal it off. I need to want to map the coordinates. I'm going to try and shake him off by going into these this asteroid field, the rings of the planet. I need to want to plot the coordinates. Otherwise, we might not get out of it again. Yeah, yes, I know, but
You're the one that liked the paint job so much. I just think maybe you should be more careful.
The proximity alarm's going off.
Right. Quick, we haven't got time to discuss it. Quickly, get to the lounge and get on the co-piloting station. We'll worry about the paint job later.
So I head down. I charge down there.
Okay.
So and then we'll head into the sort of the outer reaches of this ring. So how much would that give me for the assistance of the co-pilot? Sorry, is that a boost dice or?
This would be a boost die. And...
Okay. All right, let's see what we get then, and it's one purple and one red for the opposing.
Yeah.
Okay. Boom.
Boom? Oh, okay. It's the good boom.
Oh yeah, indeed. Sorry. That's two successes and one advantage for the All result.
Right. Now you've got this in your mind, right? This massive gas giant. There's an ice ring around it. You're bringing this kind of slow, stocky, but very solid ship into the ice with this guy working his way across the top. What are you doing?
Okay, effectively what I'm going to try and do is, if he's on whichever side of the ship he's on, I'm going to try and sort of skim past the asteroids without actually going in, and basically just tilt that side of the ship so it's in the very edge of this ring, and like I say, sort of scrape him off, basically.
Mm. Okay.
And hope that we can leave whoever it is far behind, sort of floating in an asteroid field while we pull out and zip off to our new destination.
Now, Shivok's on the sensors. There's a lot of, you know, ship wreckage in amongst the ice.
Okay.
And, so the ship does its rollover, passes really close by this rock. Another giant rock is rolling up. Forcing you to kind of turn in, and then another one, and then a pair circling around each other coming straight at you. You got to get out of this ice field. There's no sign of the guy on the sensors.
Okay. I'll try and hold it until what I think is the sort of last minute, as much as I can, and then when I think I know we can't stay here any longer, I'll pull out and sort of move out of the edge of the
ice. I'd be very happy to apply those last minutes and at the last possible seconds as setback dice.
Okay, that's fine.
So it's the same difficulty if you don't speed up.
Okay, yeah, one purple, I'm not going to.
And we're adding in two setback dice.
Okay.
And if you still maintain your assistance on the sensors, we can add in a boost die to counteract that.
Okay, since we're obviously trying to sort of keep an eye out and keep a lookout for anything that is going to potentially run into us, like large chunks of ice or floating other destroyed ships, who probably also thought this was a good idea when they sort of started on it, am I able to add my boost dice from my uncanny senses to this?
Absolutely. Add them in. Okay. And I will be a kind game master and produce Light Destiny Pool for you by spending the dark side point to upgrade the difficulty to two red, no purple.
Two red, no purple. Okay, can I then spend this light side on this roll, or do I have to wait for another roll?
You have to wait.
Yeah. Okay, that's no problem. Right, okay, let's see what we get then.
Surviving, being atomized, and stuff like that. Wow.
That'll do.
One failure, and one, two, three, four, five advantages. You failed extremely advantageously.
Oh man.
Okay.
I'm a Twi'lek. When we fail, we do it with style.
Okay, so the intent was to get out of the asteroid field. The intent has not been successful. The advantage, you went into the asteroid belt to get rid of the guy on the hood.
Yeah.
Or the roof. Whatever, the hull. And the scraping noise along the hull and the sudden loss of long-range sensors indicates you've been hit pretty significantly. The whole ship shakes, right? And its orientation spins around. And you're watching your own sensor dish tumble away, backlit by the sun, and the distinct four limbed figure outlined in the glow of the sunlight, twisting away with bits and pieces of the top of the ship.
Unlike my normal sort of talkative self, like Jamoriel, have gotten very quiet as he's sort of like wrestling with the controls, and for once all his concentration is like focused on trying not to like become another one of these wrecked ships floating in this ice field. As I try and sort of, I'm like, Shivox, there's a big block of ice in the way of our path. Try and fight plot us another way out of the asteroid field. We can't stay in there much longer.
That's right. So instead of like, if it's a band of ice, you know, instead of being up on the top surface, you're now going deeper down into the ice. You got to get out of here.
I'm going to see while we're doing that, see if we can bring drones online. See if we can, if we can shoot a path to get us out of here, right. Like, as in blow up some smaller bits of ice.
So, Shivox, I need a computer's roll from you for the sensors. Okay.
Okay, and
difficulty is standard.
Okay, that's two.
That's two.
I'm going to upgrade this with my destiny point.
Do it.
Okay. Three successes and one advantage.
Okay, the advantage can be passed on to the pilot. Right, the three successes, you do see a way out of here. Okay, so a course can be transmitted to the pilot, and the advantage can go as a boost die to the pilot.
Okay.
Or you can save it and reduce strain or whatever else you want, but the option is there to pass advantages on to the next character.
Okay, so I know that previously I had two boost dice, one from having a co-pilot and one from my uncanny sensor, so would I effectively be up to three boost dice now?
Yep.
Okay.
Jamori, you need to head that way, by next to that asteroid shaped like a potato.
We really need to work on when's an appropriate time for intership comp banter, Shiva.
No, head that way, that way.
As I sort of see the course come on my computer, what's the difficulty for this?
The difficulty hasn't changed because the speed hasn't changed. It can't get any...
It's two red.
It can only get harder, yeah. Oh, it's one red, one purple.
All right, okay,
Yeah, one red, one purple. Right. Yeah,
okay.
Whoa! One failure. Four advantages and a triumph. Okay. Closer. You're almost out.
Okay. Shivox, see if you can bring the guns online. Blow us a path through or something.
I'm on it.
I'll take the advantages to negate potential damage. So as you're maneuvering, you go around the giant one, shaped like a potato. Two rocks smash each other. Two ice blocks smash each other in your path. Particles of ice rattle all down the hull, disintegrating against the shields, but doing no appreciable damage. But you've gotten yourself significantly closer. You're on the right path. You're on your way out. Just if you can just keep it together.
I'm gonna keep sort of flying in the same path, and I'm gonna rely on Shivox to, and I'll give him my boost dice if I can from my perceptions by sort of ship pointing out the targets to him and eliminating them on his display, and basically rely on him sort of gunning us a path through all of this debris that's in our way, rather than, and I'll just be sort of flying straight up. Hopefully that'll go to a gunnery roll to yourself, Shivox.
Gunnery from Shivox.
And you've got an additional boost dice from my sensors, right, as I'm trying to highlight potential, like, you might want to destroy this or we're going to die sort of objects on your flight path.
Just hear the upper battery just unleashing, and as he, you know, grips down onto the triggers with full force. And how many difficulty was that?
This is the cool part. In space, it's two.
Okay. So let's give it a shot.
It's a target-rich environment, as they say.
Yeah. Do they say that?
So, it's two purple. That's your difficulty, and go for it.
Okay. Oh, really? That was pathetic. Two advantage. That's it.
Okay. So the linked laser cannons blaze out, and you can see them impacting on this enormous block of ice, but it's not going to give up the ghost. It's powering its way towards you through space. You're going to have to go around it.
Yeah. What I'll be trying to do is I'll be trying to, sort of, again, tilt the orientation of the ship. So I'm almost sort of skimming along the surface of it and presenting the sort of minimal frontage to be hit by this huge block of ice.
Yeah. What's the worst that could possibly happen?
At the minute, I'm like, it's the only thing I can see to do. We're too close to back away now. We're going too fast.
We'll fly through this crack.
Like I said, I'm more hoping if the surface of the asteroid's like that, as we're sort of flying towards it, we're going to sort of tilt and sort of skim round it. So we're still sort of going roughly in the same direction, but hopefully just skirting the edge of it and hopefully not losing any more sensors or ship's equipment. This seemed like such a bargain when I bought it. I've already knocked 15% off the market value.
All kinds of sensors are going off and the computer's complaining.
I would just kill the automatic sort of alarms. I'm like, yes, thank you for that, computer. I'm already aware that I'm flying towards a gigantic piece of ice. Off!
So it's one purple, one red.
Okay, here we go.
Which then. I, again, am going to be kind. Oh, no, you got it. Okay.
One success and three
advantages.
Advantages, yep.
All right. You're out of the asteroid field. Heading toward the hyperspace lane.
Over the comm link, you'll hear me like go.
That was some fancy flying, my friend.
In a slightly squeakier voice than normal, I'll be like, yeah, sir, Let's just try and get out of system without having to do that again, shall we?
And as we wind up our session, as the hour has come, pulling out of the asteroid field, heading toward the hyperspace lane, planet rotating behind you over the comms and filling the screen in front of you is the Imperial picket ship. It says, low margin, please prepare to be boarded. Fade to black.
Excellent.
Gents, thanks for joining me so early in the morning and so late at night.
Thank you very much for running it. Very much enjoyed it.
Pleasure. Pleasure. It's nice that the DICE app worked.
I really did like the sort of narrative element that the system added to it. It was nice even when we sort of failed roles. You, as a GM, you're getting stuff you could sort of like bounce it off and use it to guide what actually happened rather than it just being a case of, no, you failed.
You failed. Deal. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. It was quite nice. It certainly made for a more interesting sort of flow of the narrative, I thought.
Yeah. And it takes the blame away, too. It's like, there it is. There's the die roll. And, you know, this narrative element, right? We added this boost die or this setback die for this reason, and that's why you failed.
I like the fact of, I don't know how much of that's in the rules and how much was that you were just allowing Runeslinger, was the fact that we were lending our sort of boost dice to each other, so it really did reinforce that whole sort of, we're working together to overcome these obstacles.
No, that's what the game is. It's cooperative. You know, the pool gets built right there on the table. It's a big pile of dice, and everybody's leaning in and think, well, I could contribute this, or don't forget that it's, you know, it's foggy and he can't see. Yeah, setback die. You know, that kind of stuff. So,
indeed.
Cool. All right, well, I have to go to another Star Wars game, which I'm really looking forward to. The plot is building up to the point.
Is that when you're recording, or is it a live game?
It's live. We play in a coffee shop, so YouTube would ban us for copyright infringement.
Fair. I hope you enjoy the game and you have a good time with it. Thank you again for running this. I've very much enjoyed my first try at the game.
Pleasure. Anytime. Let's talk about it when we have a little more time. Nice to see you again, Jason.
Yep, thanks. Thank you.
Have a great
day. Nice to play with you, John.
And yourself, Jason. Hopefully it won't be the only time we get to play in a game together.
Definitely not.
So take care, everybody, and I'll see you all later.
Take care. Thanks for watching, everybody.